what was immediately striking was that a fundamental approach to the theory of knowledge was being put forward, which was at odds with what most Western philosophers have believed for about 300 years. He was saying that we actually arrive at our knowledge in quite different ways. We don't start from observation and then generalize to form theories. What we do is quite the reverse, that we form theories, or if that is too sophisticated a word, we make guesses, we have hunches, and we test these guesses and hunches against reality. Well, now, what really amazed me about the first occasion on which I saw Popper putting this fundamental idea forward was that because he expressed it in the form of a critical discussion of certain theories put forward by the pre-Socratic philosophers of ancient Greece, instead of his audience discussing the merits of the theory, they fell to discussing whether or not Popper had correctly interpreted the pre-Socratic philosophers of ancient Greece. I think Popper was himself partly to blame for the way his ideas were first received, because instead of putting them forward in a straightforward, direct, clear-cut, positive way, he had a marked tendency to put them forward in the form of criticisms of other people's ideas. To take a quite different example, but an absolutely major one, he had fundamental ideas to put forward about political philosophy. However, he puts a lot of it forward in the form of criticism of people who have had illiberal ideas. Now, this does give a lot of readers the impression that what he's primarily doing is criticizing Marx or criticizing Plato, whereas that isn't the case at all. What he's primarily doing is putting forward the positive case for freedom of the individual and openness and tolerance in our political lives. And it's only secondarily and incidentally to that that he's criticizing the main opponents of this. It often struck me that Popper, who I certainly regard as a genius and as a great philosopher, was unlike most intellectuals and much more akin to most creative artists. It's very common in the creative arts to find an artist creating something that, far from being an expression of his experience, is an expression of his lack of experience or of his inadequacies or his felt needs. An example, I mean, one of the most famous love stories in the history of any of the arts is Wagner's opera Tristan and Isolde. And just before Wagner started work on it, he wrote a letter to Liszt, who was to become his father-in-law, and said to Liszt in this letter, "I've never in my life experienced real love. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a work that is absolutely sated with love." In other words, Wagner wrote Tristan and Isolde not to express his own experience, not because he'd been in love, but because he hadn't been in love. Now, this kind of compensatory character is typical of a very great deal of art in all the various art media, I think. And it often struck me that it was true of Popper's philosophy. I mean, he was the great exponent of tolerance and liberalism in his writings, but he had a very intolerant and illiberal private personality. In his writings, he talked about criticism being the main engine of improvement, both in the sciences and in politics. But in his private life, he found it harder to take criticism than almost anybody I've known. Now, this doesn't for one moment invalidate what he said, not at all, any more than the corresponding thing invalidates the art of great artists. I think that his writings were valid and were authentic, and they were fueled, I think, in his case, as in that of artists, by a very, very deep sense of need.